Welcome, this is Dr. G, and in this video, I will be introducing moles. We'll talk about what Avogadro's number is and how we can use it, and then we'll work on some examples that teaches us how to convert from moles to molecules to atoms and back. Most importantly, in this video, I want to introduce to you guys the proper approach when tackling questions regarding mole conversions. You got this. Let's go, come on. All right, before we actually dive into moles, let me just clarify that what you see on the screen right now, these three words, they are just different ways of spelling for the same thing. They all represent moles, and most likely throughout chemistry this year, you're gonna see all three of these versions written by your teacher. All right, let's talk moles now. If I said the word dozen, you would think of the number 12, because the word dozen, although it's not a number, it's a word, it specifically represents the number 12. Just 12, not 12 eggs or 12 pieces of bread or whatever. It's just 12. There's no item associated with the word dozen. Well, same idea with mole. If I said one mole, that is 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23. Now, as a side note, your teacher may use 6.02 times 10 to the power of 23. It depends on how many decimal places they want you to keep. So just be mindful of that. This number has a name. It's discovered by a scientist named Avogadro, so naturally, we're going to call this Avogadro's number. You're only going to use Avogadro's number when you're describing one of three things. The first one is atoms, which is just a single element on its own. For example, you can say, I have one mole of helium, which is an element. The next one is ions, which is just a charged version of an element. And you can say something like, I have one mole of iron ions. And then lastly, the most common one used will be molecules, which is two or more atoms joined together. You can say something like, I have one mole of H2O or water. Okay, so now you have a bit of background information on moles. Let's talk approach. This chapter of moles, it has a very unique approach on how to do these questions. You should be, ideally, working on autopilot, like a robot when you're doing questions in moles. I know, this doesn't sound very mentally stimulating, and it's not. The more you actually think about these questions, the harder they become. Treat these questions like unit conversions. Just make sure you're crossing out the units, doing what you're supposed to do, and when you arrive to the answer, you can rest assured the answer will be good. Our approach for doing these mole conversion questions will always be to start off with what the question gives us, something that we know or something that we have. And then we take that and multiply it by a ratio. That ratio will have what we want on the top and what we know or have on the bottom. This way, we can actually cross out the units of whatever we have so that the end unit will be whatever the question's asking for. That sounds pretty simple, doesn't it? And in the beginning of this chapter, yeah, the questions you're doing will be this simple. However, later on, there just might be more steps in between. You're gonna start with what you know or what you have, and then you're gonna multiply it to a ratio of the very first step over what you know or what you have, because you can't just get to what you want just yet. As per the rule of math, we can cross out what we know, and then we just do another step maybe. We go to the second step over the first step as a ratio, and now we can cross out whatever it is in our first step, and then maybe finally we can get to what we want, and then we can cross out our second step as a ratio. As you can see, all we're doing is we're multiplying by ratios and then we're crossing out whatever we don't want to eventually get to what we want. So now you're probably wondering, okay, this sounds nice, but how do I know what ratios to use or what are these ratios even? Well, the answer is you will be taught 4, 5, or 6 ratios in this chapter. And you don't even have to do too much thinking when you're doing these questions. You just have to focus on what do I want to cross out? What do I not want? And eventually you will get to where you want. So speaking of ratios, here is the very first one. And we already learned it. It is Avogadro's number. Because then we say that one mole, let's say of water, is equivalent to 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23 molecules of water. Well, if they're equivalent to each other, then we can set them up as a ratio. We can say one mole of water on the top is equivalent to 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23 molecules of water. Can we also not write it the other way around? 6.022 times 10 to the power of 3 molecules of water is equivalent to 1 mole of water on the bottom? Absolutely. So now, if you're wondering, well, shoot, how do I know which one to choose? Again, you don't. You don't have to make a choice. Depending on what you don't want and what you want, you will naturally put the right thing on the top and on the bottom so that you can cross things out. So you never would have to make a decision of thinking, how should I set up my ratio? All right, let's take a look at this very first example on the screen here. Now, I know some of you might be able to do this question with a little bit of logic, thinking, calculator perhaps, but trust me, it's not worth it because later on in this course, you'll be dealing with much longer and complex questions. So it's more worthwhile to actually practice the skills and the strategies we just discussed, crossing out what we have to get to what we want, rather than just solving this question with logic, because logic will not be the best option moving forward. So the question says, how many atoms of neon are there in 2.5 moles of neon? First of all, what do they want? Well, they're asking how many atoms of neon, so they clearly want the atoms of neon. Okay, what do we know? Did they give us anything? Yes, they did. They told us 2.5 moles of neon. So we know that. That number, 2.5 moles, that's what we know, that's what we have. So now, feel free to pause the screen. See if you can work it out yourself. There's no pressure, it's your first time. Once you're ready, continue on, and you can see how I work it out on the screen together. Starting with what we know we have 2.5 moles of neon. Now, some students like to put this over 1 to make it look like a fraction or a ratio on its own. And that's fine, that's good. If you want to do that, you can. If you don't, that's okay as well. Next is we're going to immediately multiply that to another ratio. In this case, we know for sure we have to put what we know on the bottom because I want to get rid of it. So we're going to put here moles of neon on the bottom. Notice, I didn't put any numbers yet. Always put the units first, and then we can fill in the numbers later. Well, what do we put on the top? We want atoms of neon, so we don't have a choice but to put atoms of neon. And in this case, we think, is there such ratio between atoms and moles? And there is. We just learned it. The ratio is, for every 1 mole, there's always 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23 atoms. And at this point, we can cross out the units of moles of neons, because one's on the top and one's on the bottom, and we're left only with atoms of neon, which is what the question is asking for. And when you crunch it in, you should get 1.5055 times 10 to the power of 24 atoms of neon. However, notice there's only 2 sig figs in our question, so that means our answer has to have 2 sig figs as well. So we must put this as 1.5 times 10 to the power of 24 atoms of neon as our final answer. Example 2. How many moles of NO, or nitric oxide, are present in a beaker containing 5.10 times 10 to the power of 21 molecules of NO? Let's break down the question here. First of all, what do they want? Well, they're asking how many moles of NO are present, so that means they want the moles of NO. What do we know? What information do they give us? Well, they give us 5.10 times 10 to the power of 21 molecules of NO. So in this question, we're trying to go from molecules of NO to moles of NO. Pause the screen if you want to give it a try. When you're ready, come back and join me. Starting with what we know, which is 5.10 times 10 to the power of 21 molecules of nitric oxide. Again, I can put it over 1 if I want to. In this case, I'm not going to here. We're going to immediately multiply this by a ratio. And on the bottom, what do we put? Exactly. We're going to put molecules of NO because that's what we have and we want to get rid of it. And on the top, we're going to put what we want, which is moles of NO. Okay, again, let's ask ourselves, is there such a ratio between moles and molecules? And the answer is, yes, there is. There is 1 mole for every 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23 molecules. And at this point, we can confidently cross out the molecules of NO. And we're left with the units they want, which is the moles of NO. And all that's left to do is to calculate. And if you were to do it in your calculator properly, you should get 0.008469 with rounding. But if you look at our questions here, the 5.10 times 10 to the power of 21, that's 3 sig figs, which means we must leave our answer as 3 sig figs as well. So our final answer should be 0.00847 moles of NO. All right, third and final example. How many atoms of hydrogen are there in 0.050 moles of ammonia or NH3? What do they want? Well, they want atoms of H. And what do we know? We know there is 0.050 moles of NH3. Give it a try. Pause the screen, try your best, and then come back and we'll see if we can do it together. We're gonna start with what we know, as always, 0.050 moles of NH3. Multiplied, of course, to a ratio. On the bottom, we're gonna have to put moles here because that's what we know, which means that's what we gotta get rid of. That's never gonna be what they want. On the top now, let's think about this. Can I just put atoms of H? Well, the moles and the atoms, yeah, that's a ratio, but it has to be about the same atom or same molecule. Right now, our moles is for a molecule, NH3, but the atoms is only for hydrogen. It doesn't work. Let's focus in on the molecule of NH3. Isn't there hydrogens in NH3? Yes, and that's what the question's asking. They're asking for the atoms of hydrogen within the molecule of NH3. That means we have to figure out the relationship between the numbers of atoms of hydrogens within each molecule of NH3. So on the side here, let's take a look here. For every NH3, or for one molecule of NH3, how many atoms of hydrogens are there? Well, there's three, isn't there? Because it's one nitrogen and three hydrogens. We can create our own ratio of one molecule of NH3 to three atoms of hydrogen. And that's true because in every single molecule of NH3, there's always gonna be three atoms of hydrogen. So let's start this again. We're gonna start with what we know, which is again, 0.050 moles of NH3. We're gonna multiply this to a ratio. On the bottom, we're still gonna put moles of NH3. We don't have a choice. That's the only thing we can put there. On the top, what should we put? Well, we know that our ultimate goal is atoms of H, but how do we get there? Well, we just said that for every one molecule of NH3, there are three atoms of H. Right now, we have a ratio that links molecules of NH3 with atoms of H, and the atoms of H is what we want. So the only way to get atoms of H onto this page, onto our equation, is to have molecules of NH3 first. So on the top, we have to put first molecules of NH3. And then we think, are we allowed to do this? Can we put a ratio between moles of NH3 with molecules of NH3? Of course we are. The ratio is for every one mole of NH3, there is 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23 molecules of NH3. And at this point, before moving forward, let's first cross out the moles of NH3. A very good habit to have is to continuously cross out what you got rid of so it doesn't confuse you later on. Well, we're not done yet, so let's continue on. Multiply by another ratio here. What do we put on the bottom here? Do we have a choice? No, we don't. We have so far currently molecules of NH3 as the only units not crossed out. Is that what we want? Is that our final answer? No, it's not. So guess what? Goodbye. We have to put that on the bottom here. Molecules of NH3. And what ratio do I want to put with molecules of NH3? Now I can put it with atoms of hydrogen, because we just said that there's three atoms of hydrogen for every one molecule of NH3. And at this point, we can cross out the molecules of NH3, and we're left with atoms of hydrogen not crossed out, and that's exactly what the question wants. And crunching this into our calculator is gonna give us 9.033 times 10 to the power of 22. But notice there's only two sig figs in our question, which means our answer has to have two sig figs as well, which means it should be 9.0 times 10 to the power of 22 atoms of hydrogen as our final answer. So you can see this ratio between atoms and molecules isn't like the Avogadro's number, where that number is concrete. It's set in stone. It's always going to be 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23 for 1 mole. In this case, it's not. It depends on the molecule, and it depends on which atom you're talking about within that molecule. If you're going from moles to atoms, be careful. If you're just going straight to atoms, as in if the atom is by itself, then yeah, it's fine. We can do 6.022 times 10 to the power of 23 atoms for 1 mole. That's cool. But if they're asking about the number of atoms within a molecule, we can't just go from moles to atoms. We have to go to molecules first and then get to atoms. Let's see if we can come up with our own ratios for the atoms of oxygen with the molecules listed on the screen, starting with carbon dioxide. Well, CO2 means there's two oxygens for every CO2. So our ratio should be two atoms of oxygen per one molecule of CO2. Does it have to be written this way? Can it be flipped? Absolutely. You can also flip it. So it looks like one molecule of CO2 for every two atoms of oxygen. Next, what about the atoms of oxygen in MgNO3 2, or magnesium nitrate? Well, in this case, there's three oxygens in NO3, but there's a bracket with a 2. So we have to actually multiply the 2 in, and there's actually 6 atoms of oxygen in every magnesium nitrate. So then we write the ratio as 6 atoms of oxygen per 1 molecule of MgNO3 2. And again, we can write it the other way around. You get the idea. Lastly, what about the atoms of oxygen in water, H2O? Well, in this case, it might seem redundant because there's one atom of oxygen in one molecule of water. Even still, it's still a good idea to write it out. So we have one atom of oxygen per one molecule of H2O. Again, mathematically speaking, this does nothing to our question because times one divided by one does nothing, but the units are important. That way you can ensure that you can maybe cross out the molecules and now you're at atoms. Visually, it's much better. So don't skip this step, even if you feel like it's redundant. All right, so we're gonna start a flowchart for all the different possibilities and conversions from moles. Today, we learned that from moles, we can get to molecules or atoms through Avogadro's number. If it was to the molecules, that would be 1 mole for every 6.022 times 10 to the 23 molecules, or vice versa. And then for atoms, it's the exact same thing, except we replace the word molecules with atoms. Keep in mind though, remember, this moles to atoms only works if the atoms are individual atoms. If these atoms are a part of the molecules, like we saw in the last question, then we need to get to molecules first and then get to atoms with their own conversion, which is X number of atoms, because we don't really know how many there is. It depends on the molecule and the atom. X atoms per one molecule, or vice versa. All right, that is the end of this video. I hope you feel good about what Avogadro's number represents, as well as the conversions between moles, molecules, and atoms. There's a lot more ratios you have to know for moles. Those will be covered in the videos to follow. If you liked the video, hit the like button, and if you really like the video, subscribe to the channel, help it grow, and help me make more videos for you guys. And as always, if you have any questions, comments, or topic requests, you can write it down in the comment section down below.